Well, hello everyone and welcome again to the Natural Resources Canada series on urban trees. I'm Ken Farr, I'm a dendrologist with the Canadian Forest Service here at NRCan, and today we're going to be talking about some of the urban trees that are common in the area and that would be useful as trees for planting on properties and in and around spaces in your community. Now, when it comes to urban trees, the ones that are best suited in a way can be found just by looking around you. And that's because the list of trees that will really stand up to urban conditions, to salt, to heat, etc., is rather short. So we'll be looking at some of the mainline trees that you'd be encountering, but we'll also try and look at some slightly different trees as well. And it's worth remembering that over time, particularly in the 20th century, the choice of trees to plant in urban areas has been rather short. Elm trees were very popular early in the 20th century. We had Dutch elm and there was a problem. And the same with ash trees that replaced the elms. In the later part of the century, emerald ash borer. So the lesson, of course, is avoid planting too much of one tree. And the city of Ottawa here, where we are in Commissioners Park, has been following that approach. And you find a nice selection of trees now. So of course, that selection of diversity is what makes for a sustainable forest. And that's what we're going to look at today. Well, here we are with a tree species that's growing well here in the urban forest, but not necessarily a tree that you'd expect to encounter all that often. So this is an Ohio buckeye. It is a native tree in Canada, but only just. There are some mature trees growing in a forest on Walpole Island in Lake St. Clair in extreme southwest Ontario. The tree you might more often encounter that looks very much like this one and is closely related is what we call a horse chestnut, which is a tree from Europe. This is the native variety thereof, and it makes a very interesting tree. You'll notice it has kind of an unusual leaf pattern. It's what you'd call palmately compound, where there's five leaflets all attached at one point on the leaf stalk itself. And that's sort of unusual. And the leaves are arranged opposite one another, which makes it an easy tree to spot. Very interesting fruit, kind of a capsule, lumpy with little spikes on it. Squirrels like them a lot, not all that great, as in fact, quite inedible for us, but makes for an interesting feature, as do the flowers in the spring, kind of a 12 centimeter long panicle of flowers, yellowy green, quite interesting and quite ornamental. As a urban tree, it's slow growing, sort of a small tree, not much more than 15 meters tall, so well suited to areas where there's not a lot of space. And that's fundamental. You don't want to be planting a large tree in a small place. It takes a long time for a tree to develop, and it's really unfortunate if you find after 15 years that the tree is not going to fit where you planted it. So worth thinking about, and that's what makes this tree a good choice. It's 15 meters and maybe about 10 meters broad as they get older. They prefer moist soil, but as you can see here in an urban area, fairly adaptable. Ohio buckeye, Aeschylus glabra, a slightly more unusual choice for an urban forest. Well, here we have something slightly different for an urban tree choice. This is a Colorado blue spruce, Picea pungens. If you really are focused on planting with native trees, white spruce, Picea glauca, would make a good choice as well. And they're very similar in terms of their preferences and size and form. So why choose a Colorado blue spruce? Well, they're well known for being extremely tolerant of salt, particularly of drought, of dry soil conditions, and they'll grow well on a variety of soils as well. So for those reasons, it's a good choice for urban areas, not noted for being invasive. And in fact, you'll see them planted along highways as a kind of choice for landscaping, open road areas. And that gives you an idea of how tough and accepting of difficult urban conditions these trees are. So in the case of a blue spruce or any spruce, how are you going to identify it? Well, it's interesting. All of the needles on the tree are single and they attach to a little wooden peg on the twigs themselves. In the case of blue spruce, just as the name suggests, the needles have a beautiful blue, bright color to them, at least this cultivar. But in fact, it's just wax and it rubs off. The story there is that where these trees grow native in Colorado, of all places, in the spring, the native trees would just be slightly blue for a couple of weeks, and then they kind of fade to a dull green. These trees have been selected over time. They're cultivated varieties, cultivars. This one is named a Coster spruce. You can tell by the form, which is very columnar. There are other popular blue spruce cultivars like Hoopsie and some more interesting beach ball forms like Fat Albert that you can choose from. But this is a nice choice of tree. It gets to be quite large in the wild, 35 meters perhaps, less so in an urban setting. And what's really useful about this tree for a conifer is that it is rather columnar and narrow. Because if you think about it, any conifer that's cone-shaped is gonna be at least two-thirds as wide at the base as it is tall. And if you don't have a large space, you're gonna have the tree growing through the front window of your property after about 10 years, which just shows you've got the wrong tree in the wrong place. Another identification feature, and kind of an interesting one, the cones of this species have an interesting wavy margin to the cone scales, and the scales are loose and really flexible. Fairly pest-free and disease-free species, they do have a problem with a fungus that can kill off the lower branches and then higher and higher in the tree, but it's not prevalent. Colorado blue spruce, very common and a good choice for tough sites in the urban forest. Here we are with another common urban tree that you'll see everywhere in the landscape, and they're common because they're very adaptable. This is an eastern white cedar, Tuya occidentalis. One of the widely distributed trees in the natural forest of eastern Canada as well. A good choice in urban areas because it's very adaptable. So you'll see we're looking at rather a young tree here, and you can see how it grows up. They come in a variety of forms, some beach ball shaped, some very columnar, and some that will be conical. The growth rate is reasonably steady over time, so these trees will probably double their size and height in about 10 years from now. The usefulness of the tree is that it serves as a hedge, although hedges are difficult to maintain, so they're not as common as they used to be, but it is a good screen tree. So if you're looking to screen out noise, if you're looking to screen out backgrounds in the urban area, it's a nice choice as well. These trees will probably live 200, 300 years. The name Arbor Vitae, which has been applied to them as a common name, means tree of life. In a sense, it's a reference to the length of time these trees grow. So not really a cedar at all. It's in the cypress family, in fact. But the form is very different than the other trees we've looked at so far. If you wonder what's a leaf from this tree, each of these little scales on the twig complexes is a leaf itself. And they form little pairs that alternate over the twigs. So interesting form there. The cones are actually very small and quite minute, and that's kind of what they look like. Interesting in that they have opposite scales instead of spiral, which is what we've seen with pines and the spruces we looked at. So a couple of things to keep in mind: if you want a nice full green tree, choose a cultivar, don't choose a field grown tree, just a regular eastern white cedar. They grow clumps and clumps of cones that kind of make a hole in the foliage and turn brown, and that's not as interesting from an aesthetic standpoint. As well, it's natural for the leaves on these trees to turn brownish or purplish over the winter. Most of the cultivars out there maintain a nice green color through the winter and through the summer. So eastern white cedar, small right now, it'll get bigger, maybe 10 meters, and highly adaptable to a variety of sites. Likes a moist site with a little limestone soil the best, but as you'll see, they're very widely distributed in the urban landscape and a good choice. Well, no surprise here. I'm sure most people viewing will know exactly what tree we're looking at. It's a white birch, of course, Betula papyrifera. It's a beautiful tree to take in because it does do pretty well under urban conditions, and the aesthetics, the color of the nice white bark makes for an interesting addition to any planting. That said, white birches have their problems, particularly with birch borer, which can shorten the life of the tree. Really, 80 years is about as long as you can hope to keep a white birch growing in your landscape. And they are somewhat susceptible to drought and to compacted soils. But it's such a beautiful tree that it's really worth thinking about. So obviously the bright white bark is absolutely characteristic, but it takes about 12 years for this mature white bark to develop. Before that, the color of the stem itself and the branches is kind of a red-brown, so you have to be patient. The leaves of this, the native white birch, are deltoid, if you will, kind of oval and deltoid shape, and it has a double-toothed margin with about 11 veins on each side of the leaf going to a large tooth, and then there are smaller teeth in between the large teeth. The fruit of a white birch is quite interesting again. It's a catkin, so there's a whole series of scales attached to a central stem, and underneath each scale is a lovely little winged seed that they're released in winter, and they blow all over the landscape and travel quite a distance, and it's one of the ways these trees are extremely efficient at reproducing and covering a lot of territory. Now, it's an early a succession tree, which means they like to grow in the open. They won't grow in the shade. So not shade tolerant, you need a well-lit area to be planting these trees. They like a moist, fairly deep soil, but they are reasonably adaptable to urban conditions as well. One of the caveats, if you will, a warning about planting a tree like this, particularly in a park, is people really do love to detach the white bark, and that over time can be detrimental. But on a private property or an area where there's not a lot of traffic, that's not an issue. Similarly, people do like to carve their initials in these trees, so it's something you need to make sure there's not going to be a lot of contact with your white birch. But really a spectacular tree. Nice yellow autumn color at the end of the season, and a nice exclamation point to an urban planting. In an earlier video on red maple, we mentioned that sugar maple was not a good choice for urban forests, and that holds true. But I think it was a little unfair and really missing out on a spectacular native tree if we don't talk about sugar maple. When we said not a good choice for an urban planting, really that meant not along a street, not as a boulevard tree where the roots are going to be constricted and likely to be growing in compacted soil and experiencing salt in winter, at least here in Eastern Canada. For those reasons, these trees don't deal well with that level of stress. But here we are in an urban park in a downtown area of a city, and this is a sugar maple, Acer saccharum, and it's doing just fine where it is. The thing to keep in mind is there are lots of open space for the roots here. There's a nice soil, lots of overhead space as well. So if you're living out in the suburbs, kind of the peri-urban area, or have an expansive space in a downtown site, it's still a useful choice and a spectacular tree. So identification-wise, the leaves, of course, are iconic as a Canadian symbol and spectacular in autumn, of course, anywhere from yellow to red to purple to scarlet. Keep in mind that sugar maple, compared to Norway maple, which is a very common exotic and invasive tree species in urban areas, sugar maple, the whole shape of the tree of the leaf is square and not rectangular. There's three main veins on the leaf itself, not five, and about five lobes, sometimes three, and not seven. The other real strong characteristic for identifying sugar maple, once it becomes mature, is this wonderful bark that, as you can see, forms nice, long, vertical ridges. But each of the ridges tends to curl away from the bark, the trunk of the tree, on one side. And that curling bark is extremely characteristic. You're not going to see it with any of the other native maples, and a Norway maple does not look, does not have that characteristic at all. Beautiful, moderately fast-growing trees, long-lived in a natural forest, 300, 400 years old is a good lifespan for a sugar maple. Maybe slightly less in an urban setting, but a nice tree that you're going to have for a long time once you've planted it. Now, keep in mind that it's a big tree, which makes it an excellent shade tree. It means it can deliver all of those urban environmental services of shade, of shelter, adding to green spaces, but it's a big tree. So as much as 30 meters tall, maybe 20 meters wide, again, you have to make sure that you have a space where the tree is going to be able to develop and thrive. So a sugar maple, it's the tree that we get maple syrup from. It's a beautiful component of the Eastern Canadian broadleaf forest, and it does have its place in the urban forest as well. Well, here again is a choice of urban trees that is definitely off the beaten path. This is a tulip tree, or a yellow wood, Liriodendron tulipifera. It's actually in the magnolia family. They grow native in Canada in one spot on the north shore of Lake Erie and the southern shore of Lake Huron. And here we are in an urban forest in Ottawa in hardiness zone 5. And these trees are, there's a group of them here, and they're growing very well in an exposed site. It's a lesson that it's possible to expand the list of urban trees, and it's a bit of an experiment, but in the case here, these trees are growing very well, and it seems to have been a remarkably positive outcome. So what's interesting about this tree? Extremely fast growth, the largest broadleaf tree in eastern North America. The pioneer settlers called it Apollo of the woods because it was so large and so rapid growing. And if you look at these trees, they have an interesting form. They have a single stem from the very base of the tree right to the tip. It's called excurrent growth, unlike things like maple trees where the tree breaks up into a whole complex of branches. It makes for a very fast growth. It makes for an interesting form. And in the case of these trees, they fit into a smaller space, even though it's a large tree. So for those reasons, it's an interesting choice. And by large, I mean in nature, maybe 35 meters tall, maybe 100 centimeters in diameter, likely smaller on an urban site like this. So foliage is super interesting and really quite characteristic. You won't see another leaf like it. It's as though someone has taken scissors and cut the tip off the leaf itself. So you've got kind of 5 main lobes, and it looks as though the top of the leaf has been cut away. Nice yellow autumn color, as you can see. They have a beautiful yellow tulip-like flower in the spring. As I noted, it's in the magnolia family, so it gives you an idea of how magnificent and ornamental the flowers are. The fruit is a stalk with little wing seeds, kind of a complex attached to the stalk, and the seeds fall off individually. And another way to spot the tree is that the central stalk of the fruit itself remains attached to the tree. So very rapid growth. These trees were planted about 12 years ago, and they're topping 12 to 15 meters right now. I would say be judicious about where you plant them. They are beside a street here, but they're sheltered by other trees all around them. I wouldn't suggest planting them as a boulevard tree, but certainly if you've got a green space where there's a little shelter existing, they'll do well. Not shade tolerant, they like to have a full sun to a partial shade while they're growing as a seedling or as a small tree. So tulip poplar, a very unusual Carolinian species and doing well here in hardiness zone 5 in Ottawa in the urban forest. Well, thanks everyone for joining us again for a look at a short list of good choices for planting urban trees. We've only looked at a very short list of trees today, but if you're interested in a better description and more choices, I would suggest downloading the My Tree app from NRCan, which will tell you the hardiness zone you're in and give you a list of good choices for planting wherever you are in Canada. I'd also suggest looking on the web for some NRCan research on changing climate, changing forest zones, which looks at how the hardiness ratings we've come to know and love are changing over time and will change in the future. Above all, you know, we hope that we've inspired you to think about planting trees in the urban area, and that you'll be interested to see how the forest around you in the urban zones of Canada changes with time.
If you like this video, let us know with a thumbs up. Click on the logo below to subscribe to the Simply Science channel, and click the bell icon to be notified when we upload new videos.